same link, right? Like the one we had in the for
no,
the moon.
No. This should be with Clyde Space Company.
Oh, okay. Yes, please forward it to me. Yes.
Okay, I will do that. Okay, let us start. It is 1 o'clock, so we are back with our bi-weekly lectures. So this will be the first one for 2021, and we have Dr. Antonios Manousakis from the Applied Physics and Astronomy Department, and also our colleague the one responsible for the High Energy Astrophysics Laboratory here at the Academy. So we welcome him and we thank him for his time to give us a lecture about what's the Nobel Prize given for. Is it physics, or is it for every Nobel Prize, Dr. Antonios?
It is about physics. I think this is something that we should expect based on the department and our field. And okay. it's not only about physics, but this year in particular about astronomy and applications in astronomy and cosmology.
Okay, so please go ahead. You can start your lecture.
Yes. So, what is the Nobel Prize in Physics? Obviously, we are a bit biased. If you ever
we lost the audio
field of interest.
Yeah.
And although we have a geologist here, I can say that physics rocks, not geology rocks. Just kidding, huh? So what is the Nobel Prize in Physics given for this year? First of all, what is the Nobel Prize in general? And what is given for? Nobel Prize by Alfred Nobel, in his will, he was wanted to donate and promote actually those who during the preceding year have conferred the greatest benefit to the humankind. So this one is highlighting, the Nobel Prize in general is highlighting what happened in the previous year or a couple of years ago in a particular research field, in physics, for instance, that we are discussing here, but it's not confined to that. Nobel Prizes we have in chemistry, in medicine or physiology, literature, and peace. For peace, it's given for a slightly different reason, but it's still roughly the same idea behind that, to promote a great benefit to the humankind. This is why the Nobel Prize is given and is accompanied by a significant amount of money to support those in research. Nobel Prize, in particular in physics, was first given in 1901, and the first recipient of the Nobel Prize in physics was Röntgen. Röntgen is responsible for discovering the X-rays, and we know the applications of the X-rays ever since in astronomy, in biology, in mineralogy, in medicine, in imaging medicine, and so on. So the first Nobel Prize in 1901 was given to Röntgen for a great benefit to the humankind ever after. Imagine that in some countries, like in Germany and in Poland, in German language and in Polish language, they don't have a word for X-rays. They call it Röntgen. In Polish, for instance, when you go for X-rays, or when you want to say that you are doing X-ray astronomy, you don't say X-ray astronomy. You say Röntgen astronomy, because this is the influence of Röntgen in physics. Other fields here, we can see that they are not listed, like for instance, mathematics and computer science that they have their own prestigious and very well known prizes. Like, for instance, mathematics, they have the field medals, and computer science, they have the Turing medal, the Turing prize. But we are astronomers, so we are going to concentrate a bit more on astronomy. And the Nobel Prizes that were given in that field after 2000, with some notable mentions. As you well know, last year, in 2019, Peebles, Mayor, and Kello shared the Nobel Prize for advances in cosmology for the first one, Peebles, and for the remaining two, Mayor and Kello, the discovery of a first extrasolar planet orbiting a solar-like star. This is, again, is highlighting a significant part of research, not only the year before that, but an era before that, especially with Mayor and Kello, that they first discovered the first exoplanet like back in 1996. Before that, in 2018, it was given about, I think, some lasers, but in Nobel Prize in 2017 was shared again by Weiss, Baris, and Thorne, and it was actually on the detection of gravitational waves. And the detection of gravitational waves is opening a new window for astronomy. A gravitational wave is actually a new messenger. We don't have many messengers in astronomy. And in physics in general, we cannot learn much from many things. We have the light, and all the astronomy that we are doing here in Sharjah and in most of the world is based on light. Either if it is optical light, if it is electromagnetic radiation in general, like radio waves and so on. So it is based on the electromagnetic radiation or light. Some other instruments can give us insight on particle astronomy, or known as astroparticle, and neutrinos and so on. So it's another messenger. And now, thanks to the advancements of LIGO and Virgo, we can have a third messenger. We have the light, we have the particles, and now we have the gravitational waves. So we can study even deeper about astronomy. Several years before that, there was a Nobel Prize slightly associated with astronomy, but mainly with cosmology, by Perlmutter, Schmid, and Rees, on accelerating universe using very distant supernova as a probes on the accelerating universe. The Nobel Prize back in 2006 on Mather and Smoot on the cosmic microwave background anisotropy. And a couple of years later, at the beginning of the millennium, the Nobel Prize in 2002 was shared between Davis Jr. and Kosiba on the detection of neutrino, and Giacconi for his advancements in X-rays. And here, I would like to have a notable mention that we haven't discussed, because I set a limit only for the Nobel Prizes after 2000, an honorable mention of the Nobel Prize in Physics back in 1974 by Riley and Heavis for the discovery of a pulsar. And as all astronomers, and in particular radio astronomers, they know that at that time, a student of Heavis was significantly contributing in the discovery of pulsars, Joachim Bell. However, she was not listed as a Nobel Prize. And with this history about the Nobel Prize, we are coming to the Nobel Prize in Physics in the year 2020. Why the Nobel Prize in Physics in the year 2020 is given? So the Nobel Prize in Physics for the year 2020 is actually given, again, shared between Roger Penrose to one half, Reinhard Genzel from Max Planck Institute in Germany and in somewhere in the US, I don't recall the institute in the US, one quarter. And Andrea gets from the University of California in Los Angeles, another one quarter. So Roger Penrose was awarded the Nobel Prize for the discovery that black hole formation is a robust prediction of the general theory of relativity. His counterparts, Reinhard, Genzel, and Andrea Goetz, they were awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics in the year 2020 for the discovery of the supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy. So that is fine, but what is this general theory of relativity? What is a supermassive compact object? What is a black hole? And why all these are so important? So let's see a bit of a thought experiment to try and understand a bit the black holes and relativity and the Einstein's theory of relativity. From our everyday experience, we know that the space surrounding us, and the time is more or less flat. This is not wrong, but this is up to where our intuition can go. So imagine that you have four posts, like a table, but without that you have a table with the legs, but only the legs, and you stretch a rubber seat on that four legs. Then you make a perfectly flat space-time or a perfectly flat rubber seat. And if you have an ant, that in this case your ant can represent a photon, can walk in a straight line on that rubber seat. Now imagine that you take something heavy and you put it on this rubber seat, like a metal steel ball, and you put it on this rubber seat, you will realize that the rubber seat will start to bend and create some curvature around. The ant, as any other ant or any other photon, will do what they want. They will go to travel along the same path. However, now the path is slightly different. Instead of a flat space-time, the path now is curved, as you can see with the red line. So when we have a massive object on that space-time, this can be a star, for instance, or something much, much heavier, like a black hole. When a massive object creates a depression in this seat, the ant, which must walk where the seed takes it, finds its path somewhat wrapped. And in this case, it's how we should intuitively understand the curvature of the space-time in the general theory of relativity by Albert Einstein. This is a very general interpretation. However, is this theory tested? Actually, this theory was tested very, very long time ago, almost 100 years ago, in a total solar eclipse in southern Africa. And at that time, in this total solar eclipse, they were able to see the star on a night. Well, you map the star on the sky that you have during the solar eclipse, and you measure down the position of the star. You measure out the position of the star, and you have the apparent direction to the star. We have a coordinate system in the sky, so you can write down these coordinates. Then you are waiting for the solar eclipse. When the solar eclipse is happening, you will cover the disk of the sun. So suddenly, you will have a night. And some stars very, very close to the star, the light from this star will pass very, very close to the stars, to the sun. During a normal day, you cannot see them. But during a solar eclipse, you can actually see them. And you can compare the position that you have before and the position that you get during the light, during this solar eclipse. And you can see that actually the light is somewhat bended, deflected. When the sunrise passes near the sun, the path is slightly, a little bit altered. Here we are speaking that 1.75 arc second. Imagine that 1 degree has 3,600 arc seconds. So here we are speaking for a tiny, tiny fraction of a degree, roughly 1,000th of a degree. Yet astronomers can measure such a small changes. When we see this light, we assume that the light beam has been traveling into a straight line. However, it is not, because Einstein said, like the ant before, the light that is coming from the star is like the ant from our previous figure, and it is walking along this track, this line. When it comes close to the star, will start to deflect a little bit, and then it comes straight to us. So this is the very, very first theory, the very, very first test to check the validity of the Einstein's theory of gravity, the general theory of relativity. And it actually is working. We have another test as well. For instance, the displacement of the Mercury perihelion. This is another test. I don't want to discuss it into details. But black holes are a bit strange objects. Sun can, it has a mass. Any object that has a mass can do this to our bedsheet, to our rubber seat. Every object that has a mass. If the mass is very, very light, this disruption on the bedsheet will be very, very limited. If this object is like our sun, this disruption will be a bit more significant. And if this object is like a black hole, this disruption will be completely, completely different. Here I have a bit more about the black holes, the formation of a black hole and the light path of an object around a black hole. Formation of a black hole, here we have an imaginary astronaut sitting on, for instance, a star core, that this star eventually will start to collapse, and this star will collapse and form a black hole. As the same mass falls into a smaller sphere, the gravity at its surface, it will start rising, making it harder for anything to escape from this stellar surface. Eventually, the mass collapses into that small sphere that the escape velocity will be so large that will exceed the speed of light. And nothing can get away, because nothing can exceed the speed of light. Note that the size of the astronaut has been exaggerated to indicate this. In addition to that, we say nothing. And we really mean nothing. Not even light can escape from a black hole. This is why if we have a flashlight, a torch around the black hole, and you are sitting on top of this planet, like the little prince in the novel by Antoine Exupéry, sitting on his own planet with a flashlight, and you are an observer on the opposite end of this planet, because nothing can escape from a black hole, this light will start to bend, to follow The shortest distance in these new distorted beds, and some of these rays might escape, and you will be able to see someone that is pointing into a completely opposite direction, you might be able to see it at the other end. And this is actually something that you have seen it in a movie. If you recall the movie Interstellar, in the movie Interstellar, when you see the nice images of a planet orbiting a black hole, if such a scenario can sustain life, it's another story, but you have a planet orbiting a black hole, you, the image that you see, you have an inner, thinner image of the black hole that you can see, and this is actually coming behind the black hole. So in relativity, we can see behind a black hole. Many people ask how a black hole looks like, right? Many people are asking that, how a black hole is look. And in the next slide, I have the most accurate depiction of a black hole as created by an artist. Here it is. This is a black hole as it is created by an artist.
Beautiful one, huh?
I think it's the simplest black hole you will ever see. Black holes are beasts that are much harder to tame. It's not as simple as this. It's nice, you can say that you have a black hole, but it's not like this. Black holes are much, much harder to understand and much, much harder to explain. In every slide that you want to terrorize people, you should put some equations. And here we do exactly that. I will not going to stay, but for instance, if you want to really explain the metric of a black hole, or if you wish, the phase of this bedsheet that we described in the first slides, you can do it mathematically with this very simple equation. Because for general relativity terms, this equation is considered as a very simple. And this equation bears a name. It is called the Schwarzschild metric. And when we are speaking about Schwarzschild metric, we are speaking about a non-rotating, non-charged black hole. And you have two components, one component, the temporal component, and one component, the special component. However, in general relativity, you have a term that it is particularly interesting, and is the term that I have in the second line, that is called the event horizon. And the event horizon is proportional to the mass of the object. So in the event horizon, we have something that whatever is happening within the event horizon, it cannot escape. It cannot go away. Whatever is happening there, we will never know it. It will stay there. Like a joke we have about, you know, most probably Dr. Elias will know it, as he was neighboring this state, whatever happens in Las Vegas, stay in Las Vegas. Whatever happened within the event horizon stays within the event horizon. Nothing can escape. And this is a schematic diagram showing what is within the black hole, if we have an intuition about that. We have the event horizon, and at some point within this event horizon, the sheet, the rubber sheet that we were discussing before, it has a singularity. So it has a point that all the mass is concentrated there. A time ends at this singularity. It's much, much more complicated. And as an astronomer, I have to say, as an astronomer, I have never extended my knowledge on what is happening within the event horizon. That would be nice to do it, but we are physicists, we are scientists, and whatever we say, we should be able to compare. And whatever is happening within there, we will never have this information. So we stay only on the event horizon and what we can get from the event horizon. Penrose developed these ideas on the famous paper by Penrose back in the 64, how to describe a black hole, and showing in the Penrose diagram how a star is collapsing and is forming a black hole, and how its timing is behaving around a collapsing black star and forming a black hole. So the reddish part indicating the collapsing star, at some point the collapsing star will be trapped within the event horizon, and then the singularity will form, and everything happened within this singularity, it will stay there. Nothing will be able to escape. On a trapped surface, all the light cones are tipped inwards, and the formation of the circularity is inevitable. And this is the mathematical way that Roger Penrose had a robust estimate on the formation of the black holes. Roger Penrose, if you don't know it, it's an excellent writer that I will definitely recommend as a popularized science book. He has tremendous and amazing science book, popular outreach, science outreach books. However, he is a little bit chatty, so his books are pretty large. So this is the black hole in theory. In practice, do we know the black holes? Can we observe them? Well, now we know that we know it, we can observe them, we can see the merging of them, and we can see the gravitational wave as an imprint of the impact of the two black holes. But it was not always that easy. Imagine that general theory of relativity came around 20s. The first proofs of general theory of relativity was around the same time. But we have to wait almost until the 70s and 80s to confirm the presence of black holes in the galaxy. One of the first evidence of the black hole, one of the first black hole, and the famous bet by Stephen Hawking and Kip Thorne, was about the Cygnus X1, which is located in the Cygnus constellation. You can see the red box over here, which is a star-forming region in the Milky Way, some 700 light years away. And at that black hole, we have a donor star, and the donor star is providing the fueling material, that the fueling material is in falling spirally onto this black hole. The spiral in fall will create a bit of heat, and we can identify this heat as well as the jet. So we can measure the mass of this black hole. We know that it is a stellar mass black hole, something less than 10 solar masses, and we know it pretty well. In addition to that, we know that this black hole is spinning, is rotating, is not a stationary like the Schwarzschild case that we discussed. If we are going to discuss about rotating black hole, it's a completely different story, because there you have way more interesting physics, but I will not going to discuss that right now. But we know that black holes exist, and we had the first evidence back in the 70s. I think the first paper was around 77, having a claim that this might be a black hole. Initially, they don't believe that it is a black hole because it was too heavy to be explained. But eventually, now we know that it is a black hole, and it was proved to be a black hole. But we can go even further away. And one of the very, very first hypotheses of the theory of relativity by Einstein was that there are existing supermassive black holes in the galaxy, in the galactic nuclei. And here we have an image on the right, on the left-hand side of M87. And I select to put M87 for a reason that we have already seen the black hole and the effect of this black hole with Event Horizon Telescope. M87 is not a typical galaxy, it's a giant galaxy with a huge relativistic jet extended far away from that galaxy, as you can see this purple structure, while the galaxy is the yellowish, looking like star object, but it's not a star. It is supermassive black hole. It is much, much, much heavier than our own black hole at the center of our galaxy that I will discuss later. And thanks to the Event Horizon Telescope, we were able to map the shape of this black hole over there, which is this part, this yellowish part over here. And of course, we have simulations that you have better accuracy, that you have the event horizon, the photon ring, and so on. So whatever you see within the photon ring is actually happening behind the black hole. But still, we can see. And then I started from something which is very close to us, like the Cygnus X1. I went away to something that it is far away from us, and I will move again. The Nobel Prize was given to Genzel and Gertz about the supermassive black hole that we have at the center of our Milky Way. So at the center of our Milky Way, we can see that we have stars that are orbiting around, and we have already started, this advent almost 25 years ago. And here you can see one of the very early papers denoting the different proper motion of stars around the galactic center. And you can see the evolution of these stars, the offset of these stars as a function of time. This one was a very first attempt, but we need to do better than this. We need to have better accuracy, better resolution. We need to go, much, much deeper. How can we go deeper? We have techniques currently, and I will stay on that, that we can actually remove the effects of atmosphere. If you go out in a starry night that the weather is not very good, you will realize that the stars are flickering. The fact that the stars are flickering, this is happening because of turbulence on the upper layers of the atmosphere of the Earth. And this flickering of the star will make the stars look really blobby and difficult to distinguish, especially in a crowded field. And imagine where is a crowded field. A crowded field is at the galactic center. If it is, if we are looking far away from galactic disk or the galactic center, that you have very little stars, you don't care. But if you want to look exactly at the galactic center, that you have a lot of stars, you have to treat it very accurately, this effect of the atmosphere. How do we do that? Astronomers developed methods in order to read and understand what is the what are the effects of the atmosphere on the light of the star. And imagine that you have a star, forget that it says laser guided star. Let's say that we have a star. Initially, the light beam of this star will be a plane beam, undistorted, if you wish. But as it's passing through the different parts of the atmosphere, this light will be slightly being distorted. Eventually, will arrive at the telescope, and it will be a distorted wavefront arriving on our detector. But in order to limit and improve our resolution significantly, we have to remove the atmosphere. Well, all astronomers want to remove the atmosphere. Unfortunately, if we do that, we are going to die, obviously. So we have to come with another technique. In this case, we introduce the adaptive optics. So in this case, we put an artificial star in the star with a laser beam. With very, very powerful laser beams, we can create an artificial star in the sky, and we can actually read the distortion that is occurring on this artificial star, and we can measure it. Then we have a deformable mirror. It is a mirror that is made of a very special material, and on the back of this mirror, you have actually some tiny actuators that you can predict, and you can make the exact opposite of this distorted light beam. So when the original starlight is coming, the original starlight is coming through the atmosphere, it will be distorted, but because my mirror will be distorted as well, with exactly opposite wavefront, the outcome will be a plane parallel, or as plane parallel as possible, wavefront. So in this sense, astronomers can remove the effects of the atmosphere from the stars. And when we do that, we can go to really, 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 really tiny resolution. And in this case, this is what the Keck UCLA group by Andrea Goetz did in order to map the stars around the galactic center. In this case, the galactic center is denoted by the star. Here we can see that the size of the whole image is roughly one arc second, even less than that. So one arc second by one arc second, it's a really, really tiny. But we can see the motion of these stars. And now I will play a video that you can actually see these stars moving over time. You can see the time on top that you can see the motion of these stars. So as you can see, it takes from 1995 to 2020, it is roughly 25 years. And in these 25 years, we have one star that it completes one orbit around the center, around this star that we have over here. And because astronomers, we don't have fantasy, we decide to name the star S0-2. So, what is so particular about these stars and why would like to investigate it more? First of all, this star completes one orbit around the Sagittarius A star, which is the center of our galaxy, the gravitational center of our galaxy, under 16 years. And within this orbit and models that we have, we can estimate the mass of the Sagittarius A star, like any object, like any celestial object that is moving in an elliptical orbit, we can estimate what is the mass of the attractor. The orbit is highly eccentric. The period is roughly 16 years. And we can actually estimate the mass of this central body that attracts the star S02. And under these calculations, we estimate the mass of this object to be 4 × 10⁶ solar mass, 4 million solar masses. And in order to have 4 million solar masses, the only way to sustain this mass is by a supermassive black hole that it lies at the center of our galaxy. If you wish to compare the mass of our own Milky Way galaxy galactic center with the mass of the central black hole in M87, the difference is huge. The difference is huge. The mass of the central black hole of M87 is around 4 billion solar masses. We are speaking of a difference of a three order of magnitude. And in general, people, we have difficulties to understand orders of magnitude. In general, we have difficulties. Three order of magnitude, how does it correspond to your everyday life experience? A factor of 1,000. For instance, you can get an example of 100 dirhams. If you have 100 dirhams in your hand, you can get a rather good premium lunch or dinner, right? If you have three orders that amount of money, you will have 100,000 dirhams that you can get a quite good car. So this is the difference of three orders of magnitude on everyday example. Coming to an end, and what I would like to take to be your take-home note, it is that our galaxy harbors a supermassive black hole, and this is the case not only on our galaxy, but in other galaxies as well. All of their galaxies that we know, they have a supermassive black hole at their center. And that in addition to that, supermassive black holes at the center of other galaxies, or at the center of our own galaxy, or even black holes like Sidon X1, which is much, much lighter, it's only 10 times the mass of the sun, are great laboratories for studying fundamental physics, testing the Einstein theory of relativity, understand the role of the central black holes in the galaxies, and even now we have a new messenger to understand gravitational waves, and even more, hopefully, in the future. I think here I will come to an end. I would like to thank you for your time, and I think we are open for questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Otonios, for this nice lecture presenting the Nobel Prize 2020, and also where did it fall. So what can be said? I believe that the number of Nobel Prizes for physics and astronomy is quite small, especially
for physics we have one every year, but for astronomy I think if we have a handful of them is maybe. I don't expect that we have to astronomy or somehow related to astronomy that we have more than a dozen.
Yeah. Great. So any questions, please?
Yeah, I have one in mind.
Please.
Thank you, Dr. Otonios, for the nice talk. My question is, as we know that too many people participated in the theory of black holes, why Roger Penrose specifically was selected for this prize?
There are many, of course. Yeah. There are many, many people working on the theory of relativity. Even Einstein, as you know, Einstein was not awarded the Nobel Prize for his theory of relativity. You know that, right? He was awarded the Nobel Prize for the photoelectric effect. Yes. Explanation of the photoelectric effect. Why Roger Penrose? Roger Penrose was one of the first to provide mathematically a very robust way to explain the existence of the black holes. So this is why Roger Penrose was awarded the Nobel Prize for the most robust estimates.
And that was done in the 60s, yeah?
In the 60s, yes.
Yes. For Andrea Ghez, also it is quite clear from the astronomical observations point of view. But what about Reinhard Genzel?
They do the same thing. They do the same thing. The Gertz group did it with University of California Observatory, KEP 1 and 2, and Genzel did it with the VLT and Symphony.
But they didn't publish together their work. Yeah, they worked separately.
They worked separately, yes. They confirmed the same results.
Yeah, yeah. Like Herzebring and Russell, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Any other question, please?
I can also ask.
Daniel, please.
Antonius. Maybe you explained that and I didn't get it. Why some of the black holes are rotating and some others not?
I didn't explain that. Rotation of the black hole is occurring because of we have a conservation of angular momentum. When you have a star that it is rotating and it's collapsing, this star has an angular momentum. In order to conserve this angular momentum, it should either expel somehow with the material that is going away from the star, or it should be transferred to the black hole.
Okay.
Let's say it that. I mean, non-rotating, non-charged black holes is this a simplification of a black hole? The realistic black holes are rotating black holes.
Okay.
All the black holes that we know observationally. Although the way that you measure the spin of a black hole is a very controversial way, it's not any clear way to measure properly the spin of a black hole. However, there are evidence that all observed black holes, they have some spin.
Okay, I got that. So it has to do with the mass, I suspect. The bigger is the black hole, probably, is the higher the possibility to spin faster or
not necessarily.
Okay. I assume that since they attract everything in terms of masses, black holes are like the average geochemistry of the universe, because is like a I can imagine it as a mixture of materials. So since they attract everything, eventually the chemistry or the constituents of the black hole will be the same in all black holes.
Well, first of all, mathematically, a black hole is a singularity. It's a point. It's not an extended object. From an observer's point of view, you cannot say that, because nothing can escape from the event horizon. So whatever it goes into the black hole, we don't know what is happening there. There are theories. There are alternative theories. There are many. Alternatives, but the problem is that they cannot be tested.
Okay.
You have a chat question, Antonis. Can you see the chat question?
I have to stop sharing my screen. Give me a minute to stop sharing my screen.
Just a tricky one before you answer the chat one. If the light was able to escape, what kind of drawing we would give to the black hole? I mean, if we were artists, because you saw this artistic picture of the black hole. But if everything was attracted except light, how would the black hole you think will look like?
Give me a minute because I cannot find a way to stop.
It will look like nothing. Nothing. We can just draw what we can see. If we see nothing, you'll draw nothing. It's just, that's why they call it a black hole. We have no idea about what is there, actually. Nobody knows. So it's just, we draw the event of horizon only.
Yeah.
Sorry, let me stop sharing. Have I stopped yet?
Because light doesn't escape, but yeah.
The main problem, okay. the main issue is what is the black hole itself? What is it made of? Nobody knows. Is it quarks? Is it some kind of matter? We don't know. Actually, this is a struggle in front of the astrophysics and cosmology and physics in general. We need to discover more such objects to reveal the secret of black holes.
So the state of the matter which is there and all these, the physical and chemical properties of the black hole.
Yes, still unrevealed. Nobody knows. To the best, from a physics point of view, we can explain or define the matter deeply up to the quarks, to the level of quarks. But nobody knows if the quarks
you can go up to event horizon in general theory of relativity, even the meaning of force as we know it by Newton is changing. It is changing. In the theory of relativity, in the Einstein's theory of relativity, you don't need a force acting. What you are doing is that you have a planet that is moving along the geodesic or a light that is moving along in the geodesic, and then you have the orbit of the object. In the limiting case that you are far away from this, you can reproduce the Newtonian gravity. So the theory of relativity is a bit it's more complicated. I'm sorry that I couldn't interact more before because I was trying to find the stop sharing. It was disappearing. I can read now the questions. The first question is about... Yes, I can read it now. The first one is about a science magazine saying that the first picture of the black hole are actually not that important. It doesn't add much to the Einstein theory of relativity. That is true. Scientifically, we can see the matter as it orbits around the black hole. This one, we already know it from observations. It's not a significant discovery, and it is a significant discovery because we see it for the first time. It is not as significant as a gravitational wave because you cannot do it for many, many objects. You don't open a new window. You can do it from M87, that it has a gargantuan black hole. It's huge, it's enormous. When we are speaking about M87 black hole, it's a huge thing. So we can do it for that. We can do it most probably with a new generation instruments for our galactic center and maybe for another or two sources. So
we did it first for simulation, Dr. Antonius.
We have done it for simulation since the 70s.
Yeah.
We have simulations from that back in the 80s. We have simulations for that. And the simulations are improving, and you include polarization, you include much more physics there. But the thing is that you cannot apply it and make and derive new information from many sources, not like the gravitational waves, that as you improve the instruments, now you started with one gravitational wave per year. Now we have already gone to 20 gravitational waves with the expansion of the instrument. At some point, we are going to have thousands of gravitational waves. As I see gravitational waves now, It is like the early days of X-ray astronomy. Like in the past, in X-ray astronomy, you have Scorpion Sector 1, you have Cygnus Sector 1, and so on. Then with the advancement of instruments, you had more and more and more sources, and now you have millions of them. And regarding the second question, you mentioned briefly the shift of Mercury perihelion. How do we know that this shift is not occurring due to effects of other planets? Actually, it is tested. It was predicted by the theory of relativity, taking into account the effects of other planets. And at that close, when you are so close to the sun, the effect of the general relativistic effects on the perihelion of Mercury is more significant than the effects of the remaining planets. So it is explained, and it was one of the very, very first tests of the general theory of relativity.
Okay,
have thank I answered you. The two questions from chat?
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Antonio. I appreciate that. I believe you are holding an orange hole or a black hole.
I'm holding the Mars.
Thank you very much for this nice presentation, and I thank also the attendees for their questions. So thank you very much. I believe this is very, very entertaining. So to enrich our knowledge about black holes, especially for the students. So we thank you all for your attendance, and we give you a rendezvous for the next lecture in about 2 weeks. Thank you very much. Thank you. Take care of yourselves.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.